it must have been when I was a baby, and then I just, you know, grew with it, and I had terrible eczema in my face, in my arms, and probably my hands, I think my hands too. And if I had not been healed, I probably would still have eczema today. I'd probably still, you know, have problems with my skin and scratching and having to wear creams and that and avoid things. But praise God, I was healed, and I used to be in and out of hospital at Christian River, and I was brought to Winnipeg as well. And so she tells me about a couple of nurses in the Pegasus Hospital that they got to know me because I was there so often, and I would call myself by my name and talk to the nurses about, say, poor Margaret can't scratch, and because they would have my hand bandaged up, and they used to laugh with me. And then I was brought to Winnipeg. Apparently one time I got lost here in the city because I wandered out of the yard where I was being kept, and I went through the streets and I got lost. And but I thankfully I was supposed to follow, obviously, the third day. Praise the Lord. But that's just one thing she told me about, you know, way back. Of course I don't remember. And but I got healed with that eczema. Evangelist Ray Bradley, how many here remember Evangelist Ray Bradley? Amen. Praise God. He used to have a church on Alice Avenue. And so he came to Fish River, and my mom took me into the prayer line, and he prayed for me, and she said I was healed. Praise God. So I got healed. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No more eczema. It's gone. Praise the Lord. And but I did have a few problems later on, like when I was 10. That's different from eczema. But that's one thing that God did a wonder in my life and healed me from eczema. So, you know, healing is possible. And so, you know, don't ever deny yourself or your loved ones the faith for healing. Go for it. My mom did, and I'm so thankful. And my mom was a believer. And so I remember as a young child, my mom praying. We're the band offices in Fisher River right now. Our house was straight across the road, like directly in that area, right across the road from the band office there, personal care home. And we lived in a two-story house. Like, it was a real solid log house. It was whitewashed. We were poor. Might as well say we were poor, because like we had no electricity. We just lived in that log house that used to belong to my grandparents. And because other kids on the reserve had newer homes that they had electricity, they had TV. We didn't have anything like that. And we lit our house with coal oil lamps, and we carried wood in to heat our house. And, like, I guess others were too, but I just remember we really didn't have a lot, and we ate pretty much the same food every day. I used to get so bored with it, like, because that's how poor we were. Because my dad, he used to be a fisherman, and he had cattle, but he had to give all that up because of our condition. The doctor told him to quit fishing. He used to lay fish on Lake Winnipeg for a living, and he'd be gone every summer. I remember being also at the summertime because my dad was gone. But the doctor said, we can't do that anymore. So we went on welfare, and this is why we always ate the same food every day. Only once in a while you have something different. I remember my mom was a Christian, and she would gather us around in that old house, and we'd be kneeling around her, and she'd be praying. And like I would be about eight or nine years old. 10 years old at that time. I still remember because that's the night he got saved. And it was in May when I was 10 years old. And it was during a midweek service. And it wasn't even Sunday. It was during the week, a Wednesday night service. Thank God for pastors that keep their churches open and they don't quit. You know, they don't give up. And there was only 5 people in the church that night. And like there's a few of us here tonight. I'm so thankful for everyone that's here tonight. But he got saved. You know, that's all you need is an open door. You need Jesus Christ to be in the midst, and he sure was that night because I remember that night. I've never forgotten. I was 10 years old. I'm over 60 now, and that was one of the most precious memories that I have of my whole life. And I was sitting there in the bench, like halfway through the congregation, and all of a sudden, at the end of the service, during all the time, my dad gets up and he walks down the aisle, and he went and knelt at the altar at the front, and we went and prayed with him, and I knew he got saved. I knew he was accepting Jesus Christ as a Savior, and I'm really thankful for that, praise God. So just a word on the side there, whatever you're doing for the Lord, don't give up, even if it seems like, you know, that there's not many people or, you know, it doesn't seem to be going anywhere. Well, God's hand is in it, and souls will be saved. Amen. Praise the Lord. So my dad began to go to church, and I would always go with him. And I guess I was hungry for the Lord, not realizing it. And we would go Sunday night. We would go Sunday afternoon, Sunday night. And even though we had to get up for school Monday morning, there I would be still sitting in church, and a lot of times the service wouldn't end until 12 midnight. And you know, back in those days, they didn't really go by time, not on reserve anyway. They started at 8:30, and they did all their singing. They had their testimonies, they had the word, and they didn't rush. Then they had all the time, and they did some more singing. By the time we were out of there, many times it was midnight, and so I had a lot of church growing up, and this is where I learned all these songs. I learned so many songs just going to church like that. And my mom would go too, but they had to take turns because of the little ones we had. I'm the second oldest one, and there's 9 of us. 9 of us. We're all still living, praise God. Amen. We're all still here. 9 of us. And my oldest sister is 68. Yeah. I'll have my birthday next Sunday, and then the other ones are all one by one. Every year is about. So the youngest one is 50. Will be 52. And most of us are saved. Most of us, a couple of us have to come in, but you know, our mother prayed, and I believe they will be saved. Praise the Lord. So we're teaching our children also about the Lord, because we were blessed enough to be raised that way. So, and I know I began to sense, like at age 10, I began to sense the Spirit of the Lord, like just from being in the services. And by the time I was going to be age 11, and especially 12, I would be in the service, and really there were no other kids there. There was no other young people. I don't know why other people didn't bring their children to church, but I'd be sitting there, and I'd be wanting very badly to come to the altar. I guess the Holy Spirit was drawing me, and I'd really want to get up out of my chair, my seat, to come down to the altar and kneel there and pray just like these older people. They'd be crying to the Lord, they'd be weeping. And many times it was a quiet service, like maybe a handful. Many times, and sometimes the church would be packed out, and we have visitors from Fairford and other places. I got to know people from Fairford, the elders, a lot of them are gone now. And sometimes we have visitors from Jagged, the odd time, and Dauphin River, they say Martin. And those ones would all come at the same time. just depended what kind of service it was, what was going on. So I used to really want to go and kneel, and I would always be too scared to get out of my chair, and I just never would, because it was like I was glued to my bench and I couldn't get up. And there was no, they didn't used to come and talk to me, the older people in the church. They didn't come and ask, you know, come over and say, would you like to come to the altar? It was never like that. Even at home, my parents didn't even talk to me about it. I just knew they didn't know that a young person might need guidance. So as a result, I never ever did. I never did get out of my chair in all these years, age 11 and 12. But when I was 12, the pastor asked my dad if I could teach Sunday school because I was always in church. So and then he asked me, and I was kind of scared. And but I just had prayed about it, so I agreed to teach Sunday school. So here I was at age 12 teaching Sunday school, and I still hadn't accepted Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. But I was teaching out of the Bible, and they had the Sunday school lessons, and I would follow those. And I thank the Lord He gave me the wisdom to be able to do it. I taught smaller kids, like, I don't know, ages 7, that their age group. And so, but finally, I heard a message that fall when I was 13. This brother came up to the reserve, and he was from Teen Challenge, and he was a director of Teen Challenge, and he told the Nikki Cruz story. And I remember I was just enwrapped in the story. I was just so interested in it. And then later that fall, at home, I came across this magazine. My mom used to get Christian literature from different ministries, and this one was Christ for the Nations. And in there was a whole layout of Nikki Cruz's story of how he got saved, the gang leader. And how many here are familiar with Nikki Cruz? Have you heard of Nikki Cruz? Nobody has heard of him? Anyways, except my husband here. But that was such an awesome story, a powerful story in the 50s. He was a notorious gang leader in New York. And it just gripped my heart, and I was so drawn to the story. It was so powerful. And so then, for sure, I knew I wanted to give my heart to Jesus, but I still didn't know what to do. I didn't know how. I so badly wanted to give my heart to Jesus. And I just felt conviction, you know. But in church, I still wouldn't go to the altar. I just couldn't do it. So finally, in January of 1970, what I used to do was, after my family was in bed, my parents, they went to bed early because they had the little ones, and I couldn't sleep sometimes. I shared a room with my younger sister, Olga. So what I used to do is I would get the radio off the shelf in the living room. By this time, we had a new house with electricity, so we actually had an actual living room. The bedrooms. So I used to go and take that radio off the shelf, and I would bring it to my room, and I would put it on low and just listen. And what I would listen to was, this would be Saturday nights, and I would be listening to preachers. It's not every night I did that, because on school nights I didn't do it, but Saturday night I would take that radio and I'd listen, because I knew the preachers were on. So this one preacher I was listening to was A.A. Allen, and that night he was preaching about health, and he was giving the altar call in the service where he was, the actual service, and he says, "I'm going to count to 10. And he says, "This could be your last chance." And he was saying, "Hell," he was talking about hell, and "You don't want to miss heaven." He says, "It could be too late if you don't give your heart to Jesus Christ tonight." And then he says, "And you over in Radio Land, wherever you are, drop to your knees by the count of 10, because this could be your last chance." Did I ever get scared?